first order of business tonight will be the superintendent's report. Dr. Pelletier?
Thank you. Madam Chairman, I'd like to report on the Administrative Council workshop. We had two very successful days of workshops with the administrators, and the board joined us on the second day, and we were able to arrive at some areas for goal setting for the year, and I'd like to tie those into the report that I'm going to make, which is item number D. We'll be working on that on the next month and probably present them again in September or October to the board with some strategies and objectives underlying these very goals. I'm very pleased to say this is the first time we've been able to do this, and the first time to get all the administrators and the board members together after working for 2 days with a trainer, and from my point of view, it was highly successful, and I think the administrators feel the same way. Hopefully, we're going to do 3 more of these throughout the year, and the board will join us. I'm going to take just a few minutes, Madam Chairman, to cover the important things, because I'd like to, back to school, I'd like to highlight these are board administrative areas for goal setting this year. Can the television pick this up?
Mm-hmm.
These are in some kind of priority, and as you'll see, number one, it's curriculum, and we reaffirmed our decision to develop our language arts, math, the foreign language program that has gone extremely well. Tracking and leveling is a concern of the board. We had a big workshop last year on that, and we hope to further develop that. Staff development, which is a high priority in this school system, and needs to be coordinated with the curriculum. The career ladder, teacher certification, which is going to be upon us almost immediately, and our building needs. Again, our gifted and talented, our fourth grade pilot implementation, the K-3 developments, and the training of the people in the consultative collaborative program. Today or yesterday, Mr. Doerr and the Principal Powers sent a letter on August 22nd to parents. I think it's in your backup tonight. Relative to this?
Yeah.
No?
No, I don't recall that.
This is an outlet.
An outlet this afternoon. That's why you don't have it. And I'll pass that to the chairman and we'll get you a copy of that. Team building is our fourth priority, and that's on the K-5, our 6-8, 9-12, and K-12, as well as the Administrative Council and the school board. As many of you know, all of us are pretty new, and there's an awful lot to be done in terms of team building. Number 5 is our career ladder. First is the evaluations for 89-90, and there are 29 that have to be done to improve the functioning of the whole career ladder process. We'll say a lot more about that in first day of school. And the cadre of teachers as supporters or support and evaluators is something we're giving some thought to. The development of the middle school concept, which started last year, is ongoing. And number 7, our long-range utilization of our school facilities. I'm going to be talking about that this evening. This is the first summer we've done an extensive amount of work on all of the facilities. And lastly, an administrative performance-based pay evaluation system with professional training and support. Those are the highlights of the areas for goal setting. This comes out of 2 days of work with all kinds of ideas that were thrown out about the school system. And I'm very pleased we're able to do this. When this is refined, I'll bring it back to the board, and hopefully we can have it published. And then in May, at our last meeting, we could see how closely we came to accomplishing what we set out to do. So I'm very pleased with the system, and I'm pleased that the board gave us that kind of time so we could get some of these things accomplished.
We'll be having a teacher workshop day, Dr. Pelletier.
Yes, I'd like to say something about this, and you have the package that went to all teachers, I believe, this morning in the paychecks. This is the year of wellness, and on the first day, the faculty and staff will meet with the principals in their respective buildings. That's at 9 to 10:45. The association will have a short meeting in the morning. We'll have a health lunch. I don't know what that means, but it's in line with our wellness. And we have a keynote address by Mr. Murray Banks on peak performance. So the theme for our year is going to be wellness. The board members are invited for lunch, or even if you'd like to spend the entire day. I'm more than happy to have you for the afternoon wellness program. We hear that the speaker is pretty provocative. And if you're there, I'll be more than happy to announce you to the teachers. Also, if you're coming, it might be a good idea to let my secretary know so we can get you a wellness lunch.
Dr. Pelletier, the Fulbright Exchange.
Good. I'm very pleased that we are this year joining the Fulbright program, and Mr. Patrice Dufresne from France will be a French teacher here, and he'll teach three sections of French 2 and two sections of French 4. This, as you know, is a program that has received an international reputation in the world. And I'm very pleased that we are able to participate in this program. And I'd like to compliment Dave Perry, who spent an awful lot of time making all of the arrangements for our French teacher.
He's our teacher who's on sabbatical.
He's our teacher on sabbatical, and I believe he left today for France. He will be our Fulbright scholar there, and he will return next year to be with us. So this is our first year, I think, we've ever participated in Fulbright. So I'm looking forward to a very excellent year. And we'll make you a report, and sometime during the year, probably, we should have invite Patrice to come to a board meeting and say a few words about his country.
Thank you. That sounds good. And I think that's a program that, speaks for itself, and would be nice to be able to continue. What about the summer renovation projects? Are we in good shape there?
We're in excellent shape, and I believe I put a copy in front of you as to what we've done this summer. I'd like to just share it for the citizenry. Dee is unable to be with us. He'll be with us tomorrow. He was with us until late today, and he's picking up his wife at the hospital. We've installed carpets in 11 classrooms at the Pond Cove School. We painted and trimmed the exterior. New roofs at Pond Cove office area and breezeway. Some inside painting, and installed four sets of exterior doors. Now the middle school is not the school you saw in June. And if we hope to have, I talked to the chairman today, and we'd like to invite the council on the board on the 13th of September for a 4 o'clock walk around, for want of a word, where we can show you all this. But the IA roof completed, except for the trim panels. New truss roof over the gym connector, you'll notice that. That should never leak again. Reshingled the roof, the old section of the former high school. Painted the exterior of the old former high school in progress at the present time. Painted the trim exterior. New ceiling lights and drop sprinkler system in top floor in the old section. The old section doesn't look like the old section anymore. New ceiling in the cafeteria kitchen area. Handicap ramps being installed throughout the middle school in progress. Have ordered two handicap lifts to be installed in November. Have added additional walls to create more classroom space. The parking lot between the Pond Cove Lunt Middle School almost complete. They were supposed to be tiring that today. Excellent. Installed three sets of exterior doors, one boiler firebox being relined. Portable classroom unit is 90% complete. Media center started moving in on August the 21st. The computer lab moved in on August the 21st. The new intercom system and phone system for grades 4 and 5 to be completed. Now, at the high school, the auditorium roof's in progress, 90% completed. Emergency lights to be completed in late fall. Project pending CMP rebate. We hopefully will get a good rebate on changing those fixtures, and that's what we're taking a hard look at, how much we're going to get. Gym floor has been recoded, interior painting has been done, office and boys locker area, pool grouting was redone, and tiles were regrouted on pool deck. I just want to take a few moments to compliment Dee LaBelle, who's been here most of the summer, and who really stayed on top of this. This is the most work we've been able to do in this short period of time, and I'm very pleased with the quality. And I'm sure the teachers will appreciate what Dee's been able to do.
Any questions about this?
Do you know how many parking slots are going to be created with this new parking lot?
When I was at the meeting, and we were arguing on how to put the lines, we were talking about 85. Now, that's not new. Now, those aren't new parking lots, but when you count all those, they do them vertically the way they were, we decided at the final minute. There would be 85 parking lots. Now, we're hopeful that with those 85 and the cars parked down by where the buses used to be, that'll clean out all of the cars that were always in the way on both roads. So it probably will work very nicely.
I have a question. The additional walls to create more classroom space, has enough space been created for the classes coming through in the near future, or how long does it last?
Well,
it'll accommodate.
We have picked up, all told, 10 rooms. That's almost a school addition, when you think of it. Now, that's from a lot of rechanging in the middle school, the elementary school. I can see, unless something happens, that we should be able to live very comfortably with our facilities for a minimum of 3 years. Now, I say that because we haven't seen the enrollments. The paper called about enrollments. But if we don't, I don't know what we're going to do. Because we picked up 10 spaces, 10 stations in 3 years, in addition to what we have. And you know what we've added this year. We've added 5 people. So
5 teachers?
Five stations, by the way. Now, you see, it's between the program and the students is what gives us a big problem. Our programs are growing as well as our student body. I would hope that the bulge would get into the high school as soon as it can, so that we can get some relief. But I'm really making a guess. But remember when we started out, we said 5 years. I hope we don't say 1 year next year.
Now, what did we not get done this summer that we had committed to do with our bond?
I wish Dee were here, but I don't think there is one thing we have not started that is part of that whole thing, the portion of that bond.
Okay, no.
Except the tennis courts, I guess.
No, the tennis courts came in today at $175,000.
They haven't started them,
no,
we just bid them out.
We bid them out, so we're...
Now, these two items that you say are 90% complete, the portable classroom and the auditorium roof, is that going to create any kind of an interference as far as using the space?
I don't see any at all. At this point, we've seen none whatsoever.
So will it be 100% by the first day of school?
If it isn't 100%, they can complete it without disturbing us. You know, I don't see jackhammers and all that stuff. You know, we're too far along for that.
Any other questions?
No, I think that I took a walk around there the other night, and it's amazing how much change has been. I've heard comments from people saying how nice the old high school looks when it's been painted. And it's been a heck of a project, and it started the day after school ended, and it'll be hopefully be 99.9% complete when school starts. I think Dee and you and the rest of the group deserve a high praise for the amount of work that's been done this summer.
I would like to see one project that doesn't really affect the school program too much, but I think might do an awful lot for the community, is if you notice the front of the school, it looks superb. And I really hate to say this because I'll be shocked in the morning. But if we could take down those trees that keep it damp year round and find a picture of when the school was built and replant the entire school the way it was when it was built and do a whole new front lawn, we'd have a beautiful historical structure there that would set that school off.
Those trees probably were originally planted to be bushes.
Probably.
3 or 4 feet. They were probably taxes. Yep. And now they're up 30, 40 feet.
And the firs are beyond and into the windows, and the roots are out of the ground.
But do we actually need permission from somebody to
re-landscape?
Well, Harold may have planted those. We have to call him. Harold probably knows when they were planted.
No, I think we'd be more than happy. We would have to talk with somebody so we could find a picture of what it looked like when it was first done.
Well, I think it ought to be restored to its original state.
Yeah. Well, that's the only criticism right here, is that our landscaping one thing that comes to mind, I don't know if this was under the renovations, but I remember us making a commitment to the middle school playground surface so that that would be handicap accessible. Have we made strides in having that done?
We looked at this twice this summer, and I think we decided on, we're going to put a walkway out of there, and there will be a ramp that goes out the side door. As you face the middle school, you know the door that's on the side? There's a ramp that's going in there. The child in a wheelchair will be able to come up there onto the ramp and into one or probably two spots on the apparatus. Now, we looked into a complete covering at $5 a square foot, which we thought was much too expensive. We thought it was too expensive. We've talked to the person from the state as to how to make that accessible. The community school, Sue, is aware of what we might do. There were two or three alternatives, but the last time I talked with Dee was about 2 weeks ago when we were there. We're thinking of putting a ramp. It'll be tarmac down to the front section, probably into the middle. But there'd be access to two sections, and there are, I think, more than two. There are three, are there not? Isn't there a section on the side that's not hooked to the core?
I'm not sure. We really weren't actively in participating in that particular structure.
We are going to put a, there'll be access to that facility. I'm not sure that people are going to be as happy with that as what they would have liked.
I think we're going to have a report on Main Street 90. Dr. Pelletier, would you like to introduce Mr. Tinsman? Would you like me to?
So why don't you introduce Mr. Tinsman?
This is Richard Tinsman, Dick Tinsman, who I believe is the chairman of Main Street 90. And he has requested to come to the board tonight and tell us about the program that he is chairing.
Thank you.
See?
Very informative. Much better than standing at a podium. A little while ago, the council appointed a Main Street 90 committee, and it's composed of 15 people, myself, Henry Adams, Judy Dooley, Joe Foley, Bob Hannigan, Priscilla Hare, Audrey Jordan, Dick O'Donnell, Dick Page, Sue Rouser, Barbara Sanborn, Eugene Cole, Nancy Wright, Amory Fulton. And tonight, I wanted to spend a few moments with you telling you about the Main Street 90 program, what we're doing as a committee, and seeking your thoughts about what we might do additionally in the way of a Main Street 90 program. And it's part of an objective that the committee set to reach out to all of the boards and commissions within the community to let all of our volunteers know what was happening with Main Street 90 and seek their input. The purpose of the Main Street 90 program is that Governor McKernan challenged the communities a couple of months ago, all the communities, and they focus on their heritage and pride in tie those two together into the future and look towards programs that might either singly or single-purpose programs or programs that would continue into the 1990s to tie the heritage and pride to the future. In Cape Elizabeth, the town council accepted the governor's challenge and put together a diverse group of citizens who I mentioned, and knowing some of those citizens, you can see what a diverse group is. Some people who have served on various boards and commissions in the community, together with people who have not served on any boards or commissions, but might represent either citizens at large or some of the service organizations that we have in the community. And the council, in accepting the governor's challenge, tasked the Main Street 90 Committee with looking for issues and projects that fall between the focus, somewhere between the focus of other groups and commissions in the town, so as to not duplicate the efforts that are already being done by the boards and commissions. The task to us was very complex and yet very focused, to look for projects and issues that might benefit the town and carry that heritage into the future. Governor McKernan has directed each of the state departments and agencies to work with Main Street 90 committees from around the state and to give special attention to Main Street 90 projects to ensure that from the state's perspective that technical support or administrative support was provided to communities who had active Main Street 90 program committees on board to assist in whatever means possible with community initiatives, commitment of work crews for special cleanup fix-up projects at no cost, coordinating information from around the state to make sure that we're staffed with the best advice that we can get from the state. A couple of projects that we've already initiated that we've seen the results of that attention at the state level to make sure that commissioners at the department level in the state or staff members in the agencies in the state gave us the assistance that we needed. And we'll talk about some of those things that we found out already. During the months of May, June, and July, we met every 2 weeks to brainstorm issues that we saw in Cape Elizabeth that needed some attention. And most recently, we've been meeting to, after we've divided into subcommittees, to tackle each of the high priority items that the Main Street 90 Committee had decided were high priority items, to follow up and start bringing enough information together to take back to the town council to implement some of our higher priority issues. Some of the issues that we're focusing on, paying attention to, and not necessarily in order, are town center concept. And by that, our committee means that one of our brainstorming issues was that there was a feeling that there is no real town center in Cape Elizabeth, that people pass through either visitors or even some residents without any feel for a community center. We have the makings of that about the town hall, with our only shopping area, a number of public facilities, and police and fire, rescue, public works, and the Thomas Memorial Library, and a couple of businesses. But we're really not organized as a town center. The impression that we have as a Main Street 90 committee is that we are a little bit disorganized in terms of the town center. That there's no focal point, there's no visual, nothing visual ties everything together. So our objective is to develop a town center concept that attempts to tie together private and public sector organizations and businesses into a cohesive, functional, and visual town center. That will be no easy task. Henry Adams is chairing that committee. And we've just started into the process by looking at photos of what we have as a town center right now, and looking for what we might do to better pool that Town Center together. It could take on major proportions in improvements, public and private improvements, in and about the Town Hall area, or it may be as simple as doing some landscaping and softening the Town Center that we have in part. One of the definitions that we did deal with was that the Town Center would extend from the Tower Box Triangle down to Fowler Road, so everything in that reach will be a to look at. We've taken previous ideas for the Town Center concept by comprehensive planning committees that have been informed in the past on the comprehensive plan, and we're looking at what was proposed then and looking for what we might do from the public sector to encourage private sector involvement. Another one of the priority issues that the committee has decided on was the republishing of the bicentennial edition of Collections from Cape Elizabeth, which was done in 1965. And it was written and edited by Chris Reardon, and published by the Town in two printings in June and July 1965. Quickly went out of print, and there have been expressions of desire to see that reprinted for the citizens who have come since 1965 to make that again available. In pursuing that project, they found that the Cape Elizabeth Historic Preservation Society has also had an interest in republishing that book, and we're working with the society now to find the author, look at the copyright laws, and find out how it might be republished and perhaps updated as well. Another project create the environment for a major recycling program for Cape Elizabeth, which hopefully can serve as a model for the rest of the major communities. There are a couple of instances where recycling has been undertaken successfully and some unsuccessfully in communities around the state. We have a unique opportunity in this town to focus on something that will take this community into the 1990s. Decade and into the future with a good program for recycling. EJ Silk is chairing that subcommittee. Another priority concern was the development of the welcoming package in the town, and that has been accomplished by individual groups in the past, but has fallen by the wayside in recent times. And the thought here is that for both transients and for potential newcomers or newcomers to the community, that there's a lot of heritage and a lot of opportunity for talking about our town and let people know what we have as a community that should be expressed in a welcoming package that can carry on and help new people have a better understanding of where we have been and where we intend to go into the future. Sue Rouser is chairing that committee and has been working over the last couple of months with the League of Women Voters and other groups to pull that welcoming package and booklet together. Another high priority that the Main Street 90 committee felt was needed in the community, and something that is just now starting to be developed by other groups, is the creation of a museum within the town to emphasize both fishing and farming as our heritage and take to the future a single point of bringing together that heritage from our past. And we talked about where, and we talked about what might best create the potential for a museum in town, and about the same time thoughts and ideas were being expressed for Fort Williamsport Headlight Museum created or could be created in the Keeper's House. And we've gone to the other committees in the community and have encouraged them to not only focus on Coast Guard and our maritime heritage, but as well our fishing and farming heritage as well in that single point museum. It made a lot more sense to us to have something singly encouraging that very much from the town side as a Main Street 90 committee to ensure that that's accomplished. A couple of other priorities that, one that we've stopped having as a priority because the council has taken it as its own, was to rejuvenate the memorial monuments for veterans of armed forces, which was taken down when the Casco Bank was built many years ago. And the feeling was that that's part of the heritage of the town as well. There are many people, residents who have served in our armed forces, and we need to recognize that service to their community and to the country. The new council chairman, Councilor Jordan, also has that as one of his priorities. And we stand by to assist them, the council, in doing anything that we can to bring that to fruition. One of our other priorities has been to somehow, within the school system, bring forth a concept of why it's special to live in Cape Elizabeth, to encourage the participation of our school children in looking at our heritage and thinking about it as it relates to the future and to themselves. And we haven't yet started that subcommittee, so we can bring single focus issues to each of our committee meetings now. But it's something that we feel strongly about, that not only should we be focusing on new adults, new residents, and transients, on where we are as a community, but also involving school children in that appreciation of heritage. Those are some of the major priority issues that we have that are will take some effort. We also will be dealing with simpler issues, such as the creation of new signage for Cape Elizabeth, indicating that people are coming into the town of Cape Elizabeth and expressing some of the pride we have in our town with something as simple as we are now in Cape Elizabeth signs.
There used to be that great sign across on Shore Road that for some just disappeared one time, and I don't know whatever happened to it, but it listed when Cape Elizabeth was founded, and it kind of gave you a feeling that it was a nice feeling when you drove into town.
Yes.
You've been there for the first time or whatever.
Yes, and there was as well, there were signs on Route 77, both at the Southbourne line and at the Scarborough line, as well as on Shore Road. And that's a very simple issue and something that can be achieved very easily. And all we really need to do, we found as a committee, is to focus on issues that have need. Some ideas that worked in the past, but somehow we've forgotten them of late, and to recreate and reposition ourselves to take advantage of what we feel is so special about Cape Elizabeth. We would hope, and that's just a quick summary of where we're coming from. I think it's an ambitious program. It's a program that we will be taking as we flesh out the details to the council for implementation. And we're serving as staff to the town council, to as a committee staff, to bring the ideas to fruition, to talk about how much it costs and what should be done by giving focus to these individual items, as well as others that need to be developed in the next few months. So that's really the purpose, to share with you some of our initial thoughts and also to get your reaction to what some of our priorities are and thoughts, and see if there are other issues that you might see for a few moments with a summary behind you about what we might be able to accomplish.
Thank you very much. I feel like you've come a long way in a short time and been working hard.
We do too.
Comments from the board members.
Wonderful comment about the signs, and I think that's exactly the way that our whole committee felt about it.
It just disappeared. One of those things you all of a sudden I realized one day it wasn't there. This goes back five, six, 7 years ago.
Probably a decade.
Yeah. Or 10 years.
Yeah. Any other comments?
I'd like to just say that we'd be more than happy to cooperate internally. I can think of numerous things that you might do internally in the school system to sort of complement some of your efforts in terms of the young people.
That sounds fantastic.
It might possibly be one of our big themes, something to consider, one of our themes. So each year we have a huge theme in the elementary school. This would be right at home.
There are a couple of issues statewide that relate to that that might make that an extremely productive idea, and that is that one of the issues that I mentioned previously was that across the state there is this reawakening of pride in our communities, and on a community-by-community basis. Really all that the state is doing is to support that reawakening of pride in communities, and as a statewide event, it will be receiving a lot of attention. And I think that if Cape Elizabeth did something as a focus within its school system, that would be a unique idea by itself that would support that statewide effort.
I received a letter from Susan Friedland's office encouraging districts to look at a whole host of sort of social studies topics for next year, and one of them really encouraged a look at and possible recreation of community history and all, which is exactly what we focused on in our theme project last year at the third grade level, and then incorporated it as third grade curriculum because we've spent 2 years developing it. So we're really going to be in fine shape to keep pushing that forward.
Another thing is the about the last 3 years, I keep hearing this touched upon by different groups. I remember when the school improvement plan was being implemented, they were talking about the students of the school system going into the community and doing community-type service, whether it was delivering library books to people who were shut-ins or helping out in a nursing home or helping a lot of different ways. I've heard that mentioned as a possible graduation, the final semester, final quarter of high school for those seniors that are about to graduate. I've heard it used as a possible, and I have seen it used somewhat by a Quest project at the middle school to go out and give back to the community something that they've given to you. I keep seeing this try to happen, but formally it never seems to happen. And somehow maybe we could work together to make that a real possibility.
I think that would be great. Shared graduating seniors this year, and our school children graduating from the Cape Elizabeth seem to be a breed that share something special together as a closeness and as a class, and when they get together for their 5th reunion and their 10th and their 20th and their 25th reunions, having that as a background might not only take them through the last quarter into the graduation and through college, but also even bring them back to the reunions 25 years later. So that would be a very nice focus and something that ties in very nicely with the whole Main Street 90 idea. Something for the future.
I'd like to talk to you about that. I don't know if that could be one of your priorities, but somehow with us working together, I'd like to see that.
Sounds fantastic. And I will take that back to the committee in our next meeting.
My other suggestion, and I don't know if it's particularly a suggestion, but to me, what's special in Cape Elizabeth are the times that we do get together as a community. That the Memorial Day Parade, I thought was Americana. You know, it was like something out of Norman Rockwell. And I think Fun Day, and I would suspect possibly, although I haven't been that involved because I'm not usually here Labor Day, but that Labor Day art show. But more opportunities for everybody to come together. I know probably Rotary has their things, and Lions Club has their things, and the Volunteer Fire Department have their social gatherings, but times when the whole town comes together, all ages, I think, are very special and lend a true sense of community spirit, and I think that those are the things that we look back on as being the special things about that.
I grew up in Cape Elizabeth, and I remember as a child on a carnival, and everybody was there with their cotton candy and their rides. It was a very special time, so I agree.
I'd like to see that. Any other suggestions or questions? Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you for the ideas and the support, and we will talk again about how we might focus and implement with your concurrence. I'll appoint a committee to focus on what might be done in the schools, and it'll be chaired by one.
item on the agenda tonight is an update on the gifted and talented program, which was somewhat revamped, at least at the fourth grade level, at our June meeting, and we have asked for an update. There were some items that had not been completely been decided upon, and so I hope that we might have.
We have both Wayne Doerr, our director, and Barbara Powers is here tonight. Who would like to go first?
I would. Catch you up with what's happened since we talked in June, and describe to you some of the planning that we wanted to do. Since that time, we've been in an information gathering phase, if you will. In June, we did a teacher survey of all the third grade teachers that Claire Ruthenberg put together for us. That was to elicit from each third grade teacher input about individual to all their kids, in fact, using an attributes list, checklist, and a comment section, which our teachers did and did a very fine job of for us. Claire also met at that time with the fourth grade teachers for the first time to begin the dialogue of her work with them this coming year, and to begin the process of utilizing the consultation model and the model teaching format, whereby Claire will begin to integrate the challenge curriculum with the classroom teachers into the regular class. In July, Barbara and I reviewed third grade SRA achievement tests to look at children who are functioning at fairly high levels in math and reading and begin to develop some of the individual understanding that we need to do in order to focus on individual needs in this coming fall. As Daryl mentioned to you a short while ago, today we sent a letter to parents that describes briefly the program that's coming and the components of it, and also enlists from them input about their view of their child as a learner. We took a similar survey that we had done with the third grade teachers and attach that to the letter and ask the parents to look through that, consider their child as they see them, and tell us about how they view their child in the classroom and as a learner in general, and to place on that survey any comments they might have about their child's intellectual creativity or their interest or uniqueness as learners in particularly math and reading. Because remember, when we were talking to you, you were trying to focus now on strands of curriculum in order to maintain a fairly thorough view and presentation at first rather than take on a lot of strands in this first year or two. So we've asked the parents to do that and return that information to us. As soon as the kids get back to us, we will be taking a writing sample from all of them in order to do an analysis of that and review, again, individual creativity and written expression. And Bob and I will be meeting with fourth grade teachers on the 7th, along with Claire, and talk with them again. It's a continuous dialogue that we've initiated now with our classroom teachers to begin that process of working together on behalf of highly capable kids. And as I mentioned, we will commence in September the integration of the challenge curriculum into the classroom, with Claire doing some model teaching, doing some consultation with teachers, and then we will begin to review individual children more specifically as their performance begins to surface in the presented curriculum in the classroom. And as a last piece, and I think Daryl might have mentioned this to you at the Board Administrative Council's meeting we had last week, in the fifth grade, the challenge youngsters there will be served by Mary Jo Thompson. And that's the latest update. She will serve those kids as an instructor. They will go to her for writing.
Mrs. Russ isn't doing it?
No, Mrs. Russ is doing special education full-time at the sixth grade level, as well as the challenged children in the sixth grade. Questions? It's a little bit of a nervous time for us, but I would tell you that we're pretty excited about getting going and beginning to provide a much wider range of children's needs now, and that's very exciting.
You mentioned written expression. What about math?
Well, that was part of the review that we did in the SRAs, and one of the things we're going to do when Gary Reckitt comes on, we're going to sit down and work out the details of how we want to look at that kind of a survey. I have some ideas about that, which I began to share this week with Lyle, and that's kind of an issue, but I need to get people together now to do that. There will probably be several components of that too, inclusive of work within the program that Maya Watts has provided in math tutorial communities anyway, because there will be children, I'm sure, that will fit into that, and in fact need that, clearly.
I think you said something in your report about as the performance level begins to surface.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's exactly what you said. Does that always happen? Do the gifted students always begin to show this, you know, this wonderful ability to perform, or often are they just turned off and I don't care what's going on in the classroom?
Well, to answer the basic question, no, it doesn't always happen, and thus there is a whole subfield of disadvantaged gifted children, whereby you in fact seek those children out and look to assess potentiality, creativity. The one thing about this model that I think will begin to focus on those kinds of issues, Loretta, is that we will have a broader sensitivity toward a larger number of children. There will be staff available to work with classroom teachers, and there's a whole new sense of awareness now that you just can't say, well, my gifted child or children in this room go out and it's settled. And that's what disturbs me personally as a coordinator, director of services for kids, is that it can get settled. And the remaining 18 or 20 kids are not then looked at more sensitively throughout the year. And so I think it's important that that's a particularly significant part of this effort. I can't tell you, of course, at this point how well that will work out, but again, we're in a sort of a pilot phase and we need to find out.
I think the classroom teacher that's reaching out to all these consultants for help, is someone going to come in and see the needs? Who's going to take responsibility for this? I think you mentioned about 11 people that were available.
Yes, we did.
Where does the buck stop?
The buck stops, I view, with Barbara and I. We work with the consultants available, Claire and Gary, Marty, Carolyn, and Mary Jo. And then we work through the teachers. It's fully our intention to meet with them on a periodic basis to discuss the global issues, the instructional issues, but also the individual issues. Which kid are you concerned about at this point in a given area? Math and reading. And I think we have a great core of professionals to do that, particularly including those classroom teachers. I have just felt so good about their energy for that. And I really don't see anyone sitting back and hoping they'll get through the year without some involvement. It can't happen. It's expected of us all. And we really, it's expected of us.
Well, you said a little earlier that you were a little nervous, and I confess I'm a little nervous too, and I suspect some of my colleagues are. Would it be possible to report to us periodically and quantify what's actually happening so that we know that there have been X numbers of students involved, X numbers of hours, however you want to mention measure it? Would that be very demanding?
I don't know how demanding it would be, Peter, but I think it's incumbent upon us to do that. For you, for parents, for the taxpayer, I mean, a lot of constituencies out there. I certainly won't come and tell you that everything is rosy if it isn't, because that isn't fair either, and I don't want to put my neck out there for something I can't substantiate. I want to give it to you just the way it comes out, but I would love to do that, and I know Fabo would.
The sooner the better. As soon as you feel comfortable, if you can do it before November, by all means. We look forward to seeing you in October. But November at the latest, I think we should have some ideas.
I like an idea too, whether it be you or whoever it would involve, to know how this all is impacting on all of the children, how it's upgrading the regular curriculum as well as what's in place for the kids that need the extra.
I guess I would defer that one to my good colleague Michael, but it certainly has its significant place in this.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
The next item on the agenda is time for anyone in the audience who has an issue or any item that they'd like to bring to the board. Is there anyone that would like to speak from the audience tonight?
There are a number of people here who are concerned about the issue involving the soccer team. And the entire front row is one of the best. And a few people standing in the doorway. And I apologize for not getting this to you earlier. I had a small war with a copying machine between 7 and 7:45, and I lost. And Mr. Doar is trying to retrieve me, but I have something for you all and also for the superintendent. You might want to look at that, and I'll try and fill it in early as well. I'll give you a minute to look at that. I'm having some copies made of a letter to you all so that you can see it and you don't have to rely on just my verbal translation of it. I tried to reconstruct a brief summary of what happened in the past week. On Thursday, August 17th, a former CAPE student had a large party attended by, the number I've heard is 300, I don't know how accurate that is, young men and women. The party was in a meadow, and a number of students attended that, many of whom are members of athletic teams. On Friday, Coach Tor Nielsen asked some of his soccer players if they had attended the party. 12 young men acknowledged that they had, and when asked further had they been drinking, they acknowledged that they had done that as well. Under our substance abuse policy, students who have violated substance abuse training rules have two choices, and I submit they're not two choices. Well, one option is to not participate in sports in Cape Elizabeth for a year. But the second choice, which is the one at issue, is the students would be suspended for four games or four contests and have three meetings with a substance abuse counselor. Coach Nielsen and Athletic Director Keith Weatherby scheduled a meeting that we held on Monday evening. There were all of the soccer players in question were there, as were their parents, as was Mr. Weatherby, Mr. Nielsen, myself, and Mr. DeFusco. At that meeting, a number of parents expressed concern that although their sons had been involved in this and they felt that there were some consequences that should be paid, that the consequences should be reduced because, after all, the students had been honest and had admitted their guilt. I think the feeling was that if there was not some consideration of their admission made, they would be encouraged in the future to not admit their guilt. Another concern was that other athletes on other CAPE teams had not admitted their guilt, and that these students were going unpunished, and that there was no justice in the situation where, on the one hand, the soccer players who had admitted their guilt would be punished, and those who had not admitted their guilt would go free. The parents requested, and Mr. Weatherby and I did not have an answer, and I said to talk to the superintendent, that we consider a reduced punishment. And that might be less negative, that would involve some community service instead of suspension of the games. And I say at that point, neither Mr. Weatherby nor I felt we were in control of that policy, nor did we know, in fact, how the board felt about it. So I said that I would try to talk with the superintendent, with whom I did speak today, and he and I did talk, and I knew that people would be here, so I anticipated that we would probably have some discussion as well. My understanding from the superintendent is that we do have some flexibility if we think the situation merits it. I've written a letter to the players and to the parents, which you have a copy of, and which, if the copy machine worked, Mr. Dorr was successful in his mission. We have some copies for the parents as well, in which I indicate that I really don't want to reduce consequences, and I explain why, and I'll be glad to go into that. I don't think that the case here merits a reduction of consequences. I'm not sure what case might, but this one I don't think does. I did indicate to the parents that the community team on substance abuse is reviewing the current policies, and that we would like to involve parents and students in that effort. And I think that pretty much summarizes the history of where we are at the moment. In my letter, I think, which you also had pointed to, were able to, was your machine nicer to you than mine was to me?
Hey, up here.
No mess. We don't mess with guys.
Point out, last time I was in the high school and I saw the meter, the machine to which Frank is referring, there was a sign over it that said, temporarily not out of order. I take it that sign is still up.
We don't want to get into a highly emotionally charged.
Is that what we pulled out of the budget last year? We said we didn't need it.
We are stuck with it for two more years. Oh, it doesn't work most of the time. I indicated to parents last night when I think Mr. Brady asked the question at the end of the meeting whether or not I would go and urge on their behalf, their position, and I said that I wasn't sure that I was able to do that. I had not made up my mind at that point because I really spent the early part of the day talking with Coach Nielsen and Mr. Weatherby about it, and I spent last night from 6 to 8 talking to the parents, and I sort of I'm trying to decisions that I don't have to remake or I make. by listening to people and then making an intelligent decision. And it seems to me, when I weighed all the factors, that I didn't feel that, that there should be a reduction in parking. It seems to me that it is difficult, to be honest, but that, that does not make one unable to shoulder the consequences for that honesty. And I think that there are a lot of situations in which one is honest, regardless of the consequences. You're just simply honest. That's the way you choose to behave. And I would hope that the soccer players would look at their behavior in that light. I think there are many situations in our lives where we simply have to make a choice as to how we choose to behave. I don't think the message is that you should lie to avoid the consequences. I think the message is that you should not drink. You should follow train rules that you know about. I think that's difficult. I think that's difficult in any community. And I think that one of the unresolved issues that this community and this school and this adolescent population have to work out is how we deal with essentially a situation analogous to prohibition. The powers that be have said you shall not drink. Adults would like adolescents not to drink. The schools make rules about drinking. The state has a law, but in fact, universally, coast-to-coast adolescents are drinking. And there is, in that sense, it's sort of the, there's really no confluence there, and that's a problem we have to somehow get to the bottom of.
But don't these athletes sign a contract?
It's not a contract. It's not a contract. It's not an enforceable contract at all. It's really a statement that says they read the rules and they know what they are.
They voluntarily agree to adhere to the rules.
They don't even, it's not even voluntary. they don't want to play soccer. They have to sign that paper. Now, they can choose not to play soccer. In that sense, it's voluntary. But there is no other soccer team. That is, there is no soccer team that says we can drink and be merry, or you know, there's just one choice. If you're 17 and Cable Elizabeth, you want to play on the high school soccer team. And if you want to play on the high school soccer team or on cross country or play field hockey, you must sign the statement. So, I think there's some conflict there. Is that what you just handed out?
Yes, and as well as the regulations and the statement is
and parents sign it as well. And I think that I don't look at it as a contract. I look on it as simply know what the situation is. It's not. Vow or pledge may be stated that way, but it's really not fair to look at it that way. And it's certainly not a voluntary contract. I suppose it is. I mean, it is, and if you want to play soccer, but it's not as if they had another choice. I guess that's fine.
So practice had officially started.
Before the party. Practice having started a week ago Monday, is that right? Now, I've had my say. I think that some of the public might want their say, their reaction. They may want to aim some of that at me, or they may want to address you.
Anybody else like to speak on this? Mr. Kerrigan?
Thank you. It's Joe Kerrigan, and obviously I am here. That one of my sons, Justin, was involved with this situation. The meeting that we had last evening, it was not a meeting. It was a meeting called by Coach Nelton Nielsen to present the situation that we had. The flavor of the meeting, it was not a case of the parents requesting in any way that these boys be absolved from the act that they had done. What was presented and what was hoped for, that again, as was presented, that leniency could be possibly placed upon us because of the situation. Because of this, it was a situation whereby, and maybe to emphasize this a little bit more, that all of the teams apparently were questioned and were polled. The soccer team was the first team, and again, this is not a justification for what occurred. And there were 12 boys or 15 boys that came forward and, in fact, were honest to the situation that they had, the deed that they had done. The other teams, all of the other sports teams within the system, were asked the same question in one way or another. and I'm told that there is only one individual that came forward. Now, I, and we all were last evening, very gratified with the honesty that our children had. And, but however, in a situation such as this, that it can come out that such honesty could, they can turn and think that maybe they should have done it a different way, or maybe the way that the other members of this team, and I have to relate to the numbers that were there, 250 people, and I just have to think that there was more than just that one that came forward, or was honest enough, again, to present themselves. We're also looking at a situation whereby no incident actually took place. And again, this does not justify it. But the boys, on questioning by their authority, their coach, again came forward and acknowledged that they had participated in this deed. The situation that we have at home, when this agreement, contract, whatever we might call it, we place a great deal of emphasis on it. There is discussion. We had a great deal of, within the home and within the meeting last evening, a great deal of just disappointment in that they would take this and not respect it as they should have, and as we would have hoped to have, that they would have done it. But again, from the meeting last evening, it was certainly not a case that we wanted them to be resolved. We want them to, and it was presented in as far as a community service type of project. And a thought that I had after, and it's something that has been conveyed to me by my son, is that there's a lot of kids out there within the community, within this, that were a part of this situation, that really feel lousy about themselves. And that if you were to have a community service type of project, which would be spearheaded, focused really on the 15, however, that these or the others could partake, assist them in some way, and not necessarily they were coming forward at that point, but I think allow them to express themselves in saying that maybe they were a part of it, they were wrong that time, but maybe we can help in the service that we are doing. And so it's, you know, it's there's a lot of ramifications here. Again, it was not a situation of anyone actually being inebriated or under question in the morning. It was a question to them, and again, it's the honesty. And we're feeling, both at home and again in the meeting last evening, that we don't want to, we want to send a message, that the message is that that does not happen. That is not a part of the program, either within the sports season or outside of the sports season. It's not condoned. However, because of what they did, that they should be able to be given consideration for what we felt at the meeting last night should be in as far as an alternate program.
My name is Tor Nelson. I'm the varsity soccer coach for the boys. Since Friday morning, I have been speaking from the heart and listening with emotion and trying to enforce a policy that, as a coach, I feel I must, or I should, because that is my job. I spoke from the heart last night. Something has to be done, that the players on my team were involved with something that they shouldn't have been involved with. I also heard that they are no different from the majority of the athletes, and I say the majority of the athletes in this community. When they came forth for whatever reason, and only each one of those individuals knows the answer, whether they felt that they were deceived or what, I don't know, or whether they are basically honest and wanted to come forth, I don't know. What is going to happen here tonight, I certainly respect Frank Miles' position. He's probably made a decision that is unpopular with at least 12 sets of parents and 12 young men, and possibly the coach. I haven't had time to digest it yet. I asked the young men last night what they felt was just. They are willing to suffer whatever consequences the policy says. However, I think what's going to happen is when they leave here tonight, if the punishment stays as it is said in the policy, I think their thinking is going to be clouded by that decision. Period. And I think they are going to look at the fact that they got shafted when their friends did not. They're not going to look at the fact that they were wrong in the first place. I guess I say that out of motion and from the heart. When I spoke with the kids last night, they felt that they would like to do community work. It might be a reduced punishment. On the other hand, I like to view it as an alternative punishment. It does not necessarily have to be a reduced punishment. I would like to see it be very open, and certainly whatever alternative punishment they had, if there were any other students in town that would like to help them out with that, whether they would or not, I don't know. That certainly would be welcome, and they would welcome that support. It is a very tough decision to make, and I don't envy Mr. Miles' situation. I don't envy mine. I've got to work with these guys for the rest of the season. They were very wrong in what they did, but there was no forethought involved. And if you look at the number of people that were there, that sort of makes a pretty big statement, doesn't it? Thank you.
Anyone else want to speak?
I'd like to speak. First, I'd like to compliment the principal on the decision he made. And I feel he has no other choice. Decisions for violations of item 18 in this school system have been upheld. Last year, it happened to another group. It is very difficult to keep any institutional integrity if we don't adhere to our own philosophy. Now, a lot of time and thought has gone in to what I consider some very excellent policies. And unfortunately, I'm extremely sorry that this had to happen. However, I think when we start bending those rules for any reason, we're going to lose the institutional integrity that we started out with. And when we lose that, we have absolutely nothing. No team should even represent this community when we lose that. I think it's unfortunate. It's unfortunate for the coach and our season and how high we hold on soccer team. But I personally don't think this is even debatable. However, it's always the prerogative of the board to do anything it wants. But I wanted to state my opinion, and I want to compliment the high school principal. He made the right decision.
Yes. I'm Dana Johnson, and I'm here as an interested parent, and I basically was not prepared to sign the pledge this year because it was represented, it has been a joke. It has never been basically upheld. I would like to see it upheld. I have discussed this at length with my children. I'm a member of the community team. We spent a lot of time working on substance abuse and how to deal with it in the community. And I believe in integrity. And if you violate what you say, you sign your name to something and say, I'm going to uphold this, and then you violate it, you've got to be prepared to suffer the consequences. So that's
this is like reliving a few nightmares. I can tell you just a little bit of history and then some feelings from the former president, right? The present policy that calls for either a four-game suspension or staying out of athletics for a year, that policy was worked on, probably took about a half a year, three-quarters of a year to develop. It was done with the involvement of all coaches. It was done with the help of day one consultants who worked in other school systems developing similar policies. Okay? Part of the thrust of that policy was to try to create an atmosphere in which substance abuse, drinking, could be talked about between students and adults. Because we very much had an atmosphere in which drinking was something that never honestly got talked about between kids and adults. It was written in such a way that it would allow people to be honest, to talk with each other, and also to uphold standards. And so part of that policy is if kids get caught drinking, then there's the suspension. Or if kids come voluntarily, then it gets dealt with in a supportive kind of way and there isn't necessarily major punishment. The point being to allow an atmosphere, a climate that would allow people to talk to each other. Kids and adults. Okay? The policy that replaced was a policy that called for automatic suspension for the remainder of the season, of that playing season, independent of any circumstances. And the coaches gave away that policy of automatic suspension for the remainder of the season very reluctantly. Okay? Because the policy was always followed through. If anybody got caught drinking, they were always suspended. And there was about, I don't know how it ran, maybe one or two students caught in a given year, sometimes in a given season. So there were years where maybe as many as five kids lost their rights to play athletics, their privilege to play athletics. I think that set of rules, which is on the books, binds everybody. Once you commit yourself to a set of rules like that, it commits the students to the consequences, and it commits us to following through on those consequences, independent of how we might feel about it, because it commits us to a set of actions as much as it commits whoever gets caught. So I think the debate, that from where I'm sitting, that the only leverage, the only flexibility that you could possibly find is around how you define the word voluntary. And if you find that, I haven't looked at the policy in a couple of years now, I don't remember the exact wording. It seems to me that if the students come forward after the fact, in a manner in which they were caught, then there's no choice. It's like changing the rules after you've committed yourself to them. If they came forward, even if it's after the fact, in some way that fits the language that's actually written, then it seems to me you have flexibility. It seems to me that that's what you're facing.
I'm Mary Dawes. My son was also involved in this. I think when the children were asked the question, they really believed they were talking to their coach, and they knew they were wrong. And I did what he did it. They knew the rule. The last thing I said to him was, "You're under the rule." "I know, Mom." That was the last thing he had said to me. But I do believe that when they went in, there was no incident, no one was caught. And when Tora asked the direct question to the kids, how many were there and how many drank? How many were there? They all said yes. And how many drank? And the rest did not say yes. They really thought it was between coach and child. And they did volunteer it. And I think that's really what all us as parents and kids were trying to say was, I hate sitting in front of this thing.
Yeah.
is that we're not saying our kids were wrong, but we do say the way the question was asked, the kids felt duped. I guess that's the best way to say it.
Well, I just have one concern. It seems to me, in my experience in dealing with this policy or this issue since to last year, but that in the situations that occurred last year and as they were portrayed to me even the year before when there was an incident with a hockey team that had to do with tobacco, that in all of those situations, students were asked, did you do this? And in one measure or another, they volunteered that they did. And I think that the school is in a situation where we really are dependent on asking students, coaches asking students, were you involved and did you drink or did you smoke or whatever? And we're dependent on the students' integrity to administer this policy because we are not social monitors. Adults are not at their parties. We may hear things or we may not, but even if we do hear things, I guess again, in a sense, go to the student and say, did you do it? So that the students may or may have felt it. I can't address that, but it seems to me that from the coach's point of view and from the school's point of view, we really have no choice but to ask. We have no other way of determining it. Now, that may be or may not be law and policy, depending on how you want to view it. But I just think, in looking at the decision that I had to make, it seemed to me that the precedent was very clear. The situation here was quite clear. And I felt that was the decision that I had to make, which is why I did.
I just
want to
say one thing to you guys. I don't believe in changing the rules in the middle of the game. And that happened to you last year. And I'm still ripped about it. You won the championship game. You really won it. There was a flaw. There was no way that they could change the rule because the rule said what the referee says goes. And then they changed the rules on you. And you had to play it again and you tied it. And I still think you won because I don't think the rules should have been changed, whether they were right or they were wrong. They were in place. You won it. You should have had the championship. And I think if I voted tonight, or if I said to you tonight, I'm willing to change the rules, I'm really willing to adapt the punishment to something else, I don't think you'd really respect me very much for it. Because what I'd be saying to you is, well, we don't really mean it. And if you get yourself in a mess, you know, we'll figure out a way to make it not quite so bad. But what we don't want is for you to use alcohol. And so to prevent that, we try to do something that hurts. And obviously this hurts. We wouldn't be here saying, let us go out and sweep the streets, but please let us play soccer.
So I think we've done it. I think we've done something, or your coaches or the school has done something that hits you where it hurts. The punishment must fit the crime because they've taken something from you that's very valuable. And so I don't personally like to change rules in the middle. And I think that's what we'd be doing if in this particular case. Maybe the program needs to be changed. If so, between seasons, maybe we need to change it. And frankly, I think it does need to be changed because I think it needs to include all school activities and not just sports activities. And I think the time has come for that inequity to be solved so that it isn't just the sports people who are penalized for it. Some of my other board members like to speak. I know I was supposed to speak last, but I really feel very strongly about this, and I have to say to you where I stand.
I'd also like to address the young men. Coach Nielsen said earlier that you were no different than the other athletes, and I'd say you are different because you told the truth, and that set you apart, and you're to be commended for that. I think you're also to be commended, and your parents who come out and spoke here, for coming here tonight, which must not be a very easy thing to do. Whether or not you got shafted, I think, is a question of whether or not you learned the right lesson from this incident. It's easy to learn the wrong lesson. I've had a lot of experience with that. But the lesson for me in this case, and I've only heard about it tonight, is that there are consequences to actions. Honesty is the best policy, I believe, regardless of the consequences. If the lesson you learned, on the other hand, is that thou shalt not get caught, which is sometimes referred to as the 11th commandment, I think that's the wrong lesson. Those who think they can get away with things do get away with them for some period of time. But sooner or later, they pay the piper, and the stakes get higher and higher. And I think somebody referred here tonight to the fact that some of the kids that did not tell the truth already feel lousy about themselves is an example of that. Well, those are my emotional comments and my platitudes, but as a school board member, I think I would have to tonight support the administration. I think, as Loretta said, you can't change the rules in the middle of the course. But finally, I do want to commend everybody who came here tonight for the way this whole incident has been handled.
I keep thinking of my two kids at home, named Devons and Elliot, for telling the truth, who were at the party and who drank, and who said, "Are you kidding? I killed myself to make Marcy suffer. I'm not going to say this." A child I would have sworn would not do that. A child I didn't even think to ask if he or she had had a drink, and who looked at me and said, "No, I had three." I said, "Did you drink?" And was told, "No, I only had three beers earlier in the night." So I'm shocked. I have my own moral dilemmas in my own household. But I keep thinking of the kids that aren't being talked to. They've been talked to ad infinitum. And I keep thinking, who else should we be talking to? So while this stands alone, it can be upheld. You can talk about integrity in the system. This creates incredible disintegrity in the system of the kids. Not this decision. Their truth telling is for inside, but among the students and among the coaches. Certainly there has to be some disrespect for the integrity of the coaching system. If they talk to each other, could they have coordinated an effort? I mean, I wonder, does the boys soccer team have higher moral standards, or were they asked first?
Well, there are lots of injustices in the order of things in life. I think we all recognize that. How many of us have gone down the thruway a little faster than we ought, and nothing's happened? But
right.
Somebody else, or maybe ourselves, get caught.
Right.
Not everybody gets caught.
Life is complex.
It is complex, but...
And we've done analogies up to here.
Yes, but...
On every occasion.
All of you who've come to, you know, speak here tonight, and I gather from last night's meeting, it's been done with a great deal of fairness, dignity, willingness to listen to the other person's point of view, and I think for that you all ought to be commended.
I guess the only thing I'd have to add, and I would agree with most of the things that were said by the administration and the rest of the school board members tonight, is that we happen to live, unfortunately, in an age of disposable contracts. Whether you want to call this a legally binding contract or not, it holds just as much weight in the capabilities of the school system as it does when Reggie Jackson signs with the New York Yankees for $7 million and decides 3 years later, because he gets a better offer someplace else, that he can just decide to dispose of that contract and walk away from it. This, however, is even more important, because we're talking about illegal substances, activities taking place when you know full well they shouldn't have been taking place. And we do have a problem, and I think other people here have spoken about the problem of alcohol and drug abuse in this community. I don't think it's any different here than it is anywhere else. And to change the rules in the middle of the game this year, I think would send a signal to others, whether they have come forward and participated in that activity last week or participating in other activities in the future, is one that I would be very uncomfortable with. And I commend the principal of the high school for sticking by his guns. And I know it's going to be tough on the soccer team. And we may not win the state championship. But hopefully those of you who have come forward have learned something. And those who haven't come forward have learned something as well. And I hope, as Peter said, it's the right message that you take out of here tonight from all of us.
I'm not sure that I think that the other students are not going to be punished. I would think that every time they go out on the field and know that they were part of it too, and see you guys sitting there, that's going to be tough on them. And it may not help you right now, but I hope that later on when you look back on this, you'll realize that you did the right thing by coming forward, that you served the punishment that was set forth, and those other kids are going to have to live with the fact that they didn't. And as time goes on, I hope that it the pressure grows on them more and more, so that they'll learn to come forward too, either that or just not do it.
Mr. Mouse, could I ask that you begin to look into a way of making that a school-wide policy for all school activities?
No, I'm fine.
The thinking behind it, which I guess is that your bodies need to be in good physical shape when you're in athletics, that doesn't hold any water with me, because I think your mind has to be in good shape if you're on the math team or you're giving a speech at a speech and debate tournament. I can't quite understand why this isn't a uniform policy. Can you give us any insight into that,
know,
or
I,
where
I
we're going
with
that?
Well, I think that there's... I think where we're going with it is complicated, in that one of the problems that I think that this policy, or for that matter, the policy, if we extended it to all extracurricular activities, at the moment, this policy covers, at one point or another in the year, 75% of students in school. And I think we would probably cover another 15 or 20% of the students if we extended it to extracurricular activities. I think one of the problems that the subcommittee looking at revising this policy has talked about is this policy is not respected by the students, nor necessarily, if I misspeak, please correct me, adhered to rigidly by the students here tonight. That some got, in a sense, some admitted that they were there and were drinking, but there were many who were there and were drinking. Have not admitted it. And I'm not sure whether extending it or how extending it will affect student behavior. And I guess I have no problem extending it. It just seems to me that again, that puts the school in a situation where the only way we can really enforce them is to ask students, did you do this or did you not do this? Because school officials are not at the adolescent parties. Or we have to rely on parents to turn in their children, if you will.
Does that ever happen?
That does not happen, in my experience. The only reference I've heard to that is a teacher turning in his child several years ago. It's rare for a student to turn himself in. That happened last year. A student came and turned himself into the athletic director. This was not looked at as a voluntary referral. This was looked at as could be gone out. Got drunk with a few friends. And that student was suspended for four games. But again, we have a policy that we find it difficult to enforce and to be accountable for. And it's a policy that really is totally out of sync with, I would say, adolescent norms coast to coast in terms of what do you do when you go to a party. We as adults may not like those norms, and we may wish to create rules that state our position and our values. I'm simply saying, to me, this begins to look a lot, as I said earlier, like prohibition, with a certain group of powers that be have set some rules, and they're widely disrespected and disregarded by the great majority of adolescents. I don't know if we want to debate that now, but that's one of the issues.
I just want to make one observation. It's not like prohibition in that the prohibition against alcohol in sports is because it affects your ability to perform on the playing field. Everybody, I think, accepts that. Do they?
Would it not then affect the math team person, their ability to compute?
I'm just addressing the, yes, it probably would, particularly with a hangover. It would probably be pretty hard to perform.
Not overlook the fact that it's illegal.
Yes, but I think that it's different from prohibition in the United States in the 1930s, because we don't want athletes to drink because it affects their performance on the playing field.
I understand.
And 90%, I should think, of the athletes, or 95 or maybe a higher number, would accept that as being true. I think it's a physiological fact, isn't it, that most people agree that the abuse of alcohol over time affects the ability of somebody to run 100 yards, play soccer for an hour.
Again, this is a gray area. I think you could have a long discussion on this, is whether it's abuse. I don't necessarily see these students as, at least in the current instance, abusers. I don't know. There may have been some, but I have not heard that term used. It doesn't seem to me that they probably were abusing alcohol in the sense that we normally talk about abusing alcohol. Whether alcohol affects your ability to compete in sports, I think it depends on how much and in what timing, and I'm sure it does. It impairs your physical energy. I just think that maybe prohibition is a bad analogy. We still have a problem of dealing with a widespread student attitude and a widespread, well, I don't know how widespread it is, certainly a significant number of adults who have another attitude, and they are in total opposition. Now, I'm not unwilling to enforce those rules, and as a parent I had some as well, but I'm just saying the reality is, you know, we could extend it to other teams, other groups. I remember a discussion last spring on this subcommittee looking at it, was saying, how are we, in a sense, taking something that some people think is ridiculous now, in terms of that they don't respect it, and simply extending it to a larger group who also don't respect it. And maybe we don't care. Maybe we want to say, that's where the policy is, and that's what the law is, and that's what we believe, and that's what we'll do. But I'm saying that then, again, we're still in that same position. We rely on the integrity of the individual public.
Whether you extend the policy or change the policy, I think you should look at maybe the uniform. Yeah. Perhaps you need to meet and come back with us with an alternative plan.
My understanding is this is not my policy, this is your policy. And I think the community team is trying to present a draft initiated, this whole review was initiated by one of the town council members, so that we have a consistent substance abuse policy in K-12. And I think we will consider how widely we'd really like the input from students as well as parents.
I'd like to address the parent who felt that we are sending mixed messages to our students, to the athletes. And we have a form tonight with the cable television, we have a reporter in the audience. The board is commending these students for their honesty and integrity. They were well aware of the training rules, the gameplay rules, and the use of alcohol or any substance abuse. I think that we're going to get that message across to the community through these mediums. And there's always going to be a certain amount of backlash as far as, well, we got away with it, you didn't. But I think the board, the administration, sending some kind of a message that your integrity is part of your education, whether you get it from home or whether you get some kind of self-induced through the school system. And I just feel that to change the rules mid-season, whether they're right or wrong, that the integrity of the students is still intact.
You talk about rules are rules, and we know what we did wrong. You know, we're not asking to get off scot-free here. We're just saying that we'd like not a lesser penalty. It could be harder for all we know. Just it would open it up to other people, because right now you're talking about getting caught red-handed and telling the truth are the same thing. Right now they are the same thing. And it would, you know, we're taking almost the brunt of, there could be another 20 people. And it just doesn't seem fair to me that, you know, I know something's going to happen to me. But I'm just saying, if we do have a community thing, and it just gives other people an opportunity to say, yeah, I was drinking, but I'm not going to miss the four games, you know, and but they will have to do something. I feel that would just give a better understanding for kids and parents, kids and teachers. Because, you know, right now I just, what does honesty do for me in the school system? What does it do for me? It gets me in trouble. I'm more trouble than I should. You know, I will admit, you know, what I did was wrong, but it just seems tough for me when everybody else was too and they didn't admit it. That's all I'm really saying, that getting caught red-handed and being honest is the same thing.
I wish that those other 20 would come forward and say, here we are, and we'll join you.
But that won't happen if you say, it's just, we have four games. I'm saying that would give them an opportunity. I think just giving them an opportunity, that might happen. And hopefully it would.
You may not think more of yourself, but we think more of you. So.
But I'm just saying, in the future, though, what do I do? Do I admit it, or do I?
That's within you.
But
this is
a lesson, though. You're talking about good and bad lessons. I think this is a bad lesson.
Well, you made the right decision.
I know I did, but in the future, though, what do I do?
Keep it up.
Yeah. It's tough for me to do that, really.
It is tough.
Chris?
I don't know any of you guys, but it crosses my mind. It's maybe another way to say what everyone else has been saying to you, and that is that the difficulty of your decision, I guess, reflects the quality of that decision. And you're not honest because of what it can get you. You're honest because of something inside you. So the question that you're asking us or them, what do I do next time I'm faced with the dilemma of being honest or dishonest, the only one who can answer that is you.
See, I call that character.
I would too,
that's
but I'm just saying
and nobody
good
else
and bad
knows
lessons.
What you're doing, you know what you did.
I know what I did was wrong. And I just like to have a more positive attitude coming out of this than I do have right now.
You should feel very positive about what you've said and what you've done to this point. The fact that you're here tonight, I think, shows us that your concern doesn't put away the things that have happened.
Right.
And I think for us to sit back tonight and change the rules halfway through would just send the wrong message to those that are going to be confronted with a similar situation down the road. So we've tried to look at it from your side. I hope you would look at it from our side.
I do, but I think that is already done with this, that you're sending the wrong message.
Okay. Anybody else like to say anything? Anybody on the board?
I have just one correction. When we do the substance, I think I mentioned Mr. Brady, and I think Mr. Carrigan was the gentleman involved. Were you not, Mr. Beebe? Were you not
at the meeting?
At the meeting,
yes.
Was it John Brady? Okay, I thought maybe it was you, Joe, and I thought, did I confuse people? Okay, so I'm not seeing double or...
Not yet.
I just do my bifocals, by the way.
All right, we're going to take a five-minute break at this time. Now in session again.
Part two.
Yeah.
I trust that the board has had an opportunity to read the minutes of the June 12th and June 13th meeting.
I move that they be accepted.
Do I hear a second?
I second.
Is there no discussion about this? All in favor? All right. The minutes are approved as read. Under special items, we have a consideration of the superintendent's nominations for new teachers for the school year of 1989-90.
This has been probably the year where we've added more staff and non-certificated people as well. We're anticipating 30 new people. Most of whom will be full-time. Formally, I'd like to recommend the following for the board, and there is a veto behind each one of these. Sarah Lewis, kindergarten, special ed teacher, Janet Faber, guidance counselor, 4 and 5 half-time. We hired today, I'd like to add, it's Amy Melick, M-E-L-I-C-K. Special ed teacher, 1 half-time, Nancy Miles. Grade 6, Paul Casey, French teacher, Sue Leonard, 1/5 time, language arts, 1/2 time, grade 8, Linda Hull, guidance counselor, middle school, Rick Madden is one of our own, social studies high school, Donald Lord, math high school half time, Elaine Brownell, physical science high school, 1/2 time, Craig Clark, speech therapist, Beth Ware, and our school lunch supervisor, Susan King. I just want to say that I'm extremely pleased with the quality of the finalists. The applicants were probably 1,000 for all of the positions, and they're still coming in. We've had a huge expenditure on advertising this year. One of the things that I was impressed with, the number of people that worked on interviewing committees, including the board, just numbered a host of people. The elementary had a very thorough process, including videotapes and even live teaching. And we discussed that in our workshop about how to consolidate that for everybody. All in all, if you reviewed all of these vitas, I think you'll find we've got some pretty outstanding people. And I might say they came quite high on the salary schedule. In other words, for the most part, not all of them, are pretty much experienced, as you can see. So I'm looking forward to working with them. And if you're at our luncheon, you'll meet them again on the first day.
How many new people are we adding or replacing from last year? That was said well, wasn't it? How many new people are we going to have teaching here in the school?
30 minus 6.
Okay. And that represents, out of how many do we have in teaching positions?
About 131 in June, point something. We had 9 resignations. We added 4 or 5 classes. We had, how many pregnancies, Barbara, to date?
As Barbara, we told you we're smart.
The rabbit population has been significant.
Yeah, in our school, we'll be responding to three issues.
So you see, our large number is for some very good reasons. Additions, retirements, and pregnancies.
Are there new positions we've added that didn't exist before?
Yes.
And all, those are all classroom positions?
That's right, those are all.
And foreign language.
Foreign language and classroom position.
Guide.
There's two guidance positions?
Oh, they're not.
They're not addition.
They're not addition.
Do I hear a motion that we accept these candidates?
Second.
Any questions? All in favor?
Sue Weatherby?
Excuse me.
Yes, Barbara.
Can I say something first? The process of bringing these 26 or so new people on really, as Daryl indicated, takes a lot of team effort. Between the administration, the teachers, and the school board, we all have played roles in this whole process this year. But of those 26 or 24 or whatever, we'll do final count. It sounds pretty impressive. I'm going to run out of time introducing them at our first luncheon, I think. One person has been a part of every single one of them, and that's Connie Brown. She has played point person for us over here in this office incredibly well. She's the first person these people talk to when they call to respond to an ad. She has taken really personal interest in all of them and encouraged them and followed through with enormous professionalism. Being here this summer when a lot of us had staffs out on vacation, she did much, I'd say 99.9% of all of the typing, got letters out, put schedules together, typed the thanks for interviewing with us letters. It was just unbelievable. And she was unflappable. We could dump all kinds of stuff, and she's found to say, okay. She was great. And on behalf of the administrative team, we'd like to present her with an opportunity to take her husband to dinner to thank her for all of this.
I enjoyed it.
Yeah, I know you did.
Many thanks to you, Connie, to all of us. That's well deserved. Sue Weatherby will give us an update on the summer recreational program. I kept seeing a billboard out there that said, all sessions full. So we'll find out why.
Well, we did indeed survive the summer program, and I'm really pleased to be here to share some of the successes with you. I should qualify that by saying we've survived it thus far. The program hasn't officially come to an end and won't do so until Thursday when our 19 cyclers return from the White Mountains.
Did we said 19 go?
19 so left. We're assuming 19 will return. They have been touched. They're having a wonderful time. They're someplace between the White Mountains and the Maine coastline. But the summer program will officially come to a close on Thursday when they return. And it closes this year, leaving me with some really mixed emotions. The first one is a relief, of course, that the summer program is over and we have survived it. And the second is a feeling of excitement for the success that we had, not only in the day camp program, but with the new capability camps that we offered this summer. Last year, when I came to you with my final report, we had some concerns. There were some things that we felt we had done real well. There were some age groups that we felt that we had challenged. And there were other areas that we felt definitely needed improvement. And we set a goal for ourselves last year, and that was to implement more programming for the day camp population, which was first through sixth graders, and in addition to that, to better serve that sixth to ninth grade age group that we really hadn't been doing much for over the past few years. The year-long planning process started with us forming a committee. In the past, I hate to admit that no one thought much about the summer program until March. Well, we became too big to begin our planning in March, and we knew that it had to be a year-long effort. And so we did indeed form a committee, and that was comprised of parents, our advisory council members, members of our previous summer staff, as well as the entire community services staff. And we began our effort by doing a needs assessment in the middle school. We surveyed the parents and we surveyed the students themselves. And we came up with 25 enrichment opportunities that we were going to institute as part of the day camp program in the afternoon hours, giving the day camp more structure in the afternoon. We also came up with a possibility of 21 capability camps to serve that 6th through 9th grade population. It's risky business. You don't know how it's going to fly when you propose something like this. We did an individual flyer for these capability camps. My goal was to be able to go with 12 of them, and in fact, we had sufficient enrollment in 17, and many of the camps reached maximum enrollments and had large waiting lists. In the specialty camps in the afternoon for the regular day camp kids, we had over 570 enrollments just in that afternoon session. The capability camps had over 260 enrollments. Previous years, we had served about 60 kids in that particular age group. So we were real pleased with their successes. In your report, I have included some statistical data reflecting our growth over the past three summers. In the first and second grade age category, we had 208 different first and second graders, which is certainly a high percentage of the first and second grade population in the elementary school. In the third and fourth grade age division, we served 201 different kids. The fifth through ninth graders, we served 268, which was an increase of about 120 over the previous year. We had some kids enrolled in just swim programs, and our numbers were about 47. And as the day camp filled and we reached what I considered our maximum numbers in terms of offering a quality program, we closed the day camp, and we had some dissatisfied citizens because they were unable to register their children at the last minute. One particular week, we had 409 youngsters just in the day camp program, and I really felt uncomfortable trying to manage those numbers, even though I had increased my staff by three more full-time people. We just didn't have spaces to put them. So the focus became on how many non-residents are you serving in this summer program. And the numbers are low, comparatively speaking. We had 945 different registrations in our summer program this summer, of which 89 were non-residents. 10 of those non-residents, or 10 of those 89, were staff people's children, either summer program staff or day school staff children that we took into the program. These non-residents did have to wait a period of about 6 weeks before they were able to sign up. They went through all of the pre-registration requirements. Citizens that chose to make decisions at the last minute lost out. They were unhappy with us. I was unhappy that we couldn't serve them, but we just couldn't.
I noticed in here you said you would look at that for next year.
Yes.
Do you have any thoughts now on how you would change that, or am I asking you to respond to something you haven't?
If we look, we are going to look at it, because it became a real concern for some of our Cape residents. If we change it, do we need to change it for our adult programs as well? Because at this point, we do give preferential treatment to citizens up until a certain date. That date is very well advertised. After that time, in the past, we have taken people on a first-come, first-served basis. If we change the summer program format, do we need to also change our policy regarding all of our other programs? This policy has never been tested until this year, so I don't know, and I certainly would value the input of this board as well as our advisory commission on that particular point.
Madam Chairman, may I ask a question? Yes. What do you think of the feasibility of adding an academic component to the summer school under another division? In other words, it would be your bailiwick. Like, you know, you'd have to staff it.
are you saying you want these to be credit courses?
Time on task, gifted, remedial, and just what do you think of the idea? Will we would get some support for that?
I know that we have had some requests, mostly from out-of-towners. Do we offer, you know, academic-type classes in the summer? We have not done so. I'm not sure what the supply and demand is out there for that, Darrell. I know that when
Board Member Holt sent me some stuff from New York, I believe, wasn't it?
Yes, it was from the New York Times.
And very growing summer schools, back to, you know, 10 years ago, for academic credit, just like almost school extension.
I know that when we conducted our survey among the 4th through 8th grade population, it was real interesting to see what the parents wanted the children to do and what the children wanted themselves. And the classes that actually went this summer were enrichment-oriented, but not real academic-oriented. And the kids wanted to do the lifelong hobbies. They wanted to do the sport training sessions. Although we had a great response to things like photography, video and filming. So we did a lot of things for the non-athlete as well. But it was interesting to see what the parents wanted and what the kids wanted themselves. We found that in designing our program for the 1st through 5th graders, the parents make the decisions for what the kids want to do. Once they get to the 6th graders, the kids make the decisions as to what they want to take part in. So I'm not sure.
Worth discussing.
I think that you'd have at least some interest there because there's a fair number of parents who pay a pretty high rate for tutorial services. And in other cases, I had 2-3 parents who had to look at sending their children to Deering for summer school makeup credits or the I-95 school. So I had a fair number of inquiries that were, and some responses that required some expense as well as some inconvenience in terms of travel. So if it were located locally and something that was available for a lot less than what you'd pay a private tutor or the learning center in South Portland, you'd get some interest for sure. I don't know how much, but there's some interest there.
Probably worth a survey. If you have an opportunity to survey during the year, you could add that to the survey.
You don't have any like triplets in your family, because every time I turned around, somebody said, "We can't believe Sue is at 9 places at the same time." I think that from what I heard from people who participated in the program for the first time this year, and those who have been participating in the program for a long time, my family included, I think you guys would be committed, because you run a program that is the envy of every community in the area. And you do have problems with success, because the better you get, the more want to participate. And as the school system continues to grow and school systems around here continue to find out about what you offer, you will have a problem. And I don't envy you as the percentages grow and the students that you handle grow, but you are to be commended, because you guys do a heck of a job in this. I can't imagine what the town would be like without it.
Thank you very much. And as far as your problem with the residents not having a place because of being filled by non-residents who waited the required amount of time, that problem may solve itself. If word gets out, it fills up, you very well will find, I think, that people are registering early. And it seemed as though, according to the information you gave us, that you gave everyone ample time. And I think you need to keep your public filled. In June, we were given the main assessment tests for one of the grade levels. I think it was grade 8. Grade 8 or 4?
It was grade 4.
And during that time, we found some, where we had some discussion about the gender gaps among the scores by the boys and girls, and Mr. Kramer was going to check back with us early this fall, late summer, with some information.
So assuming that all of this is in your packet.
It is.
Mrs. Brown is just as helpful to me as she was to all of the administrators. I summarized all of the information on the chart to fill those first two pages. You can probably skip over unless you have some questions about specific differences in schools. What I did, and I hope this is clear, is on chart two there, I listed the difference in scores for the boys and girls in all of the group tests, all of the grade levels. At the bottom of the page is the year 85, 86, is up to the top of the page is the past school year. Grade 11 is not on there because the time is being printed. We didn't have those scores back in the state. It's right up on the scores between boys and girls in grade 11 on that chart. I'll be able to get those by real soon, I'm sure. Some general comments that I'd like to make is that the girls tend to do better in the reading, writing, and humanities. Well, the boys did better in the areas of science and social studies. The math is pretty much an even split, with both boys and girls doing very well in math. The one that showed the most difference consistently was the area of writing, where the girls scored higher every single year, every single grade level. And reading is close behind. In the area of science, boys scored higher most of the time. That wasn't always true. The same thing is true in the area of social studies. Math, as I said, is kind of a split, but if you look at the math real closely, you'll notice that another little pattern there kind of stands out, and that is that at the 11th grade level, the boys score higher. And again, that's by a fairly significant amount of points. So if you look at the math and science, you get kind of a different picture if you look at just grade 11 than if you look at grades 4 and 8. 4 and 8 is the form of this. When you look to the high school grades, then the general difference appears much more than it does to the year or grade levels.
How do these numbers relate to any averages that we can get from other schools? I mean, are these differences the same in other school districts? Do we have some that are higher?
The only way we can do that with other schools is to write to the schools, I'll go get that information from the state, do the subtraction, and put together a report like this. The state, and this is one of the commissioner's priorities, is to take a look at and try to develop some programs for improving the gender differences in the scores. As I recall, the state pattern of differences is pretty similar. The scores may not be the same, but the general pattern.
This is actually a nationwide, if not worldwide, problem. I mean, I know that there's research at MIT and lots of other universities on this very thing, and it goes clear back to boys playing with blocks in preschool and girls not playing with blocks. I think it's interesting that we see how it pertains to us in Cape Elizabeth, but I certainly don't think that it's only a problem here or in this state.
That is for sure. And fortunately, as you point out, there's a lot more research being done in this area now. I was watching a public broadcasting program that dealt a lot with the college boards, gender biases and racial biases, and the kind of biases that you get into the of the points that I found interesting, at least, was that in the higher socioeconomic communities, they were seeing, in some cases, bigger gaps in gender scores than some of the lower socioeconomic communities.
But what are we going to do about this? When we do remedial work, and someone's behind, they have to help them catch up. If the girls are always ahead in writing, and there's never been a time that the girls weren't considerably ahead, often by 100 or more points, what are we going to do as a school system to make that differential stop?
Well, there are some things you can improve and some things you can't. Like Jan says, there are some things that are just so socially ingrained that you're going to have to expend an awful lot of effort and resources to make a little amount of gain. On the other hand, there are certain patterns here that may come from such things as boys being encouraged to take more math science courses than girls. And some of those things, I think, you can impact.
I can see that happening by grade 11. But how could that apply in grade 4? What's happening by then?
I think my feeling is that in grade 4, the differences that you see there consistently are probably more related to this social and cultural kind of influences.
Barbara, what do you do in an elementary school to help the boys write better?
Treated with equity.
In 10 words or less.
Yeah.
Do you think that the whole language of everybody being encouraged to write, work on the spelling later if you get...
They're certainly writing a lot, both boys and girls. I think telling you my experience as a third grade teacher and watching kids' task commitment to writing was certainly stronger from the girls, a little bit more of a mature approach to writing from the girls, a little bit less interest in doing probing, reflective writing from some of my boys who still wanted to write about silly things in Burger King and French fry jokes. Okay, so I think there's some maturity in the writing process certainly that we can support but also give a little space to. My main concern is that there's equity instruction going on and that all children are having opportunities to write and write and write. And then it'll be kind of interesting to watch and see when some of that might pull together a little bit more.
Any other comments?
Thank you
very much. We'll see what happens this year.
Maybe we could have some influence at the state level on what the writing prompt is that might get boys more excited about the nature of the prompt, too. You know, that has a great deal to do with how well our children succeed is what they're being asked to speak to, and this lady over here has something to say about that. So
if they ask for monster stories.
Yeah, right.
Actually, too, they've looked at that very carefully, the committees that designed the test, and having worked the past 3 years on the Language Arts Committee doing the reading and the writing prompt, working with a lot of research that tells us that for boys to be really interested in longer reading passages, it has to have a male character. Females will read anything. So we've tried to put a lot more of that in. However, of course I meant that in the best sense. The other thing is that anything with good taste, of course. So we tried to pick a lot of stories that will appeal to young gentlemen. However, in doing that, you have to be careful that you don't get too many male characters as opposed to female characters, because that's another part of the gender gap issue in literature. In the writing prompts, trying to really look at prompts that will invite fourth graders, who for the first time, this is the time that they write on demand, meaning that in whole language instruction, there's a lot of self-selected choice about your topic. In the writing sample for MEAs, it's a dictated topic. You do not have a choice. And the committee looking very much in depth at, shall we open it up to self-selection? Will that help us better? Looking at research that says that boys have really made a lot more use of the writing process in the conference issue, and that's how they improve a lot of their writing. That research they're still conducting, it's not completed yet. In this writing sample, that does not allow for that to happen. So some of the things that they are maturing and getting into, the writing sample doesn't address.
Do they have a choice in the writing sample?
They do not have a choice at this time. There are two different prompts, but it's determined by which paper you get, which prompt you have.
Okay, consideration of new policies.
Tonight we're presenting two new policies for the first reading. The first one is the written policy on referral to the pupil evaluation team. This is merely with the new regs and the new laws. This year we'll come to you with three or four new policies in special ed. We're being reviewed in special education at the end of the year, so we hope to get all our policies in order. This is just how a youngster is referred. This is the first reading, and I would ask that it be placed on the board meeting of September for the second reading. And we're working on a couple others. And this is to comply with the new regulations. If you have any questions, our Director of Special Ed is here.
Are there questions? Should this be read aloud?
As a matter of fact, we will make it available at our next board meeting. We do that, have copies in the event somebody did want. Happy to give a copy to the press.
And we'll have this as a second reading?
September, the whatever that is.
All right.
The second one is a canned policy. You'll note that the we never do this. However, this was done for the entire state. Here is the law. It's from the center, the Maine Center for Educational Services. It's a sample hazardous substance communication policy for school districts, again, in compliance with the law. It's not the way we write our policy. However, it's pretty well done. And everybody is just adopting it the way you find it. I might add that we've done a lot of work on hazardous substances in the school system with one of our chemistry teachers, and Dee have worked all last year on a project. And as you know, there are several laws on where they're stored, what you use, how you use it, a host of things. And every school is being examined. And consulting firms are coming around, even removing some of the stuff. We're doing our own at the present time. And Fred Jones, who was a chemistry teacher, has been in charge of that for almost a year. But we do need a policy, and I'm presenting this for the first reading from the center. The only change would be our district would be listed in the parentheses on page 2.
Any questions? Any comments? All right, we'll move on. Consideration of a partial leave of absence.
Right, this is a letter under item 8 of your newly formed organized agenda from Mary Brooks, asking for partial leave while she helps the state survive in terms of certification. I recommend it, and Mary would bring back to us all of the expertise in terms of certification, which is going to be, from now on, our responsibility locally. And that's going to take an awful lot of doing. That, along with her career ladder, would keep her certainly busy. We discussed this at the workshop. Some of the duties will be spread among the other administrators from time to time, but Mary will be back 5 days a month to make certain.
Plus one night a week.
To make certain we don't over-administer the whole thing.
Or mess up what she's got.
I thought it was that.
Are there any questions?
Will there be someone specifically in charge when she's not here, or have you?
Yes. I'll be in charge if they need to talk to me, and I'll take over the, or I'll be in charge of the outside evaluator. The training, Michael's going to help with the staff development coordination. The training. Wayne's going to help. We're not certain yet exactly where, but we're going to sit down with Mary to see what's hanging. So Wayne doesn't know what he's going to get yet, but he's volunteered.
I'm used to things where we don't know what's hanging. As long as it's not me.
Mary, that speaks well of you, that it takes three people to touch you.
I think it's also extraordinary to be able to say that this appointment was not one you sought. Now, that is the best kind of appointment that you can possibly get, and it speaks very highly of you.
Well, then, could I just comment to the board reference that point here? In this room, there are four ISGs. That stands for Instructional Support Group. And that, to my knowledge, that's quite unique in that in one school district, there are four ISGs. None of those people go out and seek that honor. They are requested by divisions in the Department of Education to come into the department as experts, recognize quality professionals in their fields. And I don't know how much the board knows about that, but I think it's pretty commendable that in your district you have four people who are recognized fairly widely across the state for the quality of their work.
Do I have a motion that we accept partial leave of absence for Mrs. Burns? All in favor? Okay. Have a nice year. We'll be glad you'll be around part of the time.
Thank you.
Consideration of resignations.
I have two. Superintendent recommends acceptance of the resignations of Joycelyn Green and Christine Cotter, both middle school counselors.
Do I hear a motion that we accept these two resignations?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? I have here a letter from Anine M. Stanford. In regard to 120-day notice, dear Mrs. Pond, the Cape Elizabeth Education Association hereby gives written notice of its intent to negotiate wages, rates of pay, or any other matters requiring or not requiring appropriation of money for the 1990-1991 employment year for the bargaining unit comprising the aides and library assistant. Sincerely, Anine M. Stanford, Cape Elizabeth Education Association's co-president. Is received. Thank you very much.
Madam Chairman, could I just remind you and the board members, last year at this time, we met with some people representing the, I want to say the right thing, the Jewish organization, concerned about our September dates for Jewish holidays. You'll notice in your backup, Jewish calendar, along with board policy, will be placed in the first check. And the holidays in September are weekend, Saturday and Sunday, I believe. But as you recall last year, if you get any calls, I just wanted you to know that we followed through on what we said we would do a year ago.
By placing it in the check, you mean that each teacher will be notified that
gets a calendar plus our policy.
It's also a description of the holidays, which I found quite interesting, and that, you know, the teacher might want to use that to discuss it with the students.
Our next meeting will be, do we have a calendar?
September 12th.
Well,
I have one more.
Mr. Holt?
Terrell, maybe you can answer this, and I don't mean to screen anything on you, but we spent a lot of time last year talking about exchange students. Where do we stand with exchange students this year, you know?
Yes, we have three. Two from Spain and one from Norway.
We have homes for them, I assume.
We have homes for them. It was the only condition under which we would accept them.
That's...
It is a self-limiting device.
Thank you.
This is not for discussion, but unless you want to discuss it, this is more to think about. This is the first time we've had a board meeting in the boardroom where it's been televised. We always run into the difficulty, you know, we can't change a meeting because of the television. If this seems to work, then that restriction might be lifted.
Well, this is taped, just so you know. This isn't going on live. This is being
No.
This is not live?
No.
They told us it would be live.
There are people home just...
We need to have an entire crew that we couldn't get for a live shoot.
We were told today it would be live today.
Also, I think the consideration is that people expect it a certain night and make their plans a certain night. And so even though it would be broadcast, should be broadcast live, that still is not really consistent with our night. Is there any further business coming to the board?
So can we have a school board meeting on the 12th?
September the 12th, 7:30. Do you hear a motion for adjournment?
Second.
Favor?
See you in September.
Did they move?